In this session, we're going to talk about the placement feature. I suppose what we've been seeing so far this week is maybe a bit of a simplified view of the actual network that will be used. I think you've seen this picture before with OSM, and then we have the VIMs and WIMs. In reality, maybe the network looks like this. There's a lot of VIMs to choose between, and then you can decide, well, where do I want to put my VNFs or my services? So this thing is about deciding in which VIMs do we put the VNFs. So in OSM, there is an optional module. It's a new thing. It's been around since release 8. So it's not that mature, if you like, but it's an optional module, which we call PLA, which supports the lifecycle manager module to make this decision automatic and optional in case the client, OSS in this picture, then requests automatic placement. So I just going to see if I can. Sorry. So again, OSM then supports this concept of multi-site deployments. So you can map a VNF to a specific VIM when you do NSCreate by using this initialization parameters and the --- config option. If we look at the left-hand side of the slide, this is a picture that's taken from the white paper written by the end user advisory group from OSM. And the paper is called Deployment and Integration White Paper. And this presents a view of a possible network layout for a business service or an operator, you may say. So it can have a number of local data center, number of global data center, and some. This, in this case, refers to customer premises. So if we consider the example we're looking at in this Hackfest, part of it at least, we have a firewall, we have the LDAP, we have a Wiki, and we have the virtual desktop. And if we have this setup of VIMs, we could think that, okay, the firewall, we place it on the edge. And maybe we put the Wiki on some sort of global data center because we want to have it reachable for many locations, for instance. But it's not maybe that certain. Where do we put the virtual desktop? Should it go there? Should it go there? Or should it go there? So this is the question. How to make best use of the available infrastructure for a service instance? And we could think in many different dimensions here. Maybe we need to deploy a VNF as close to a consumer as it must be, or as far away as it can be, or we want to deploy it at some place so we reduce the transport load and things like that. And this placement feature aims to make this process then automatic and optional. And the thing we considered in this case is, what does it cost to put a specific VNF in a specific VIM? What is the cost of compute? What is the cost of the networking? What does the link costs when we do interworking between VNFs in a network service? And are there any constraints in the network service? Like, we have to have not more than this amount of latency, or not more than this amount of jitter, and things like so. So these are the things that we try to think about when deciding where is the optional placement for a specific VNF. So it works like this. I think we have some disturbances. You So displacement function, it works on different models. We have a model of the interconnected beams. How are these things connected? What kind of cost and what kind of characteristics do we have for the links between the beams? What is the compute cost for a beam? What is it cost to run a VNF in a specific beam, and actually even per tenant? So that can also be defined. And then this module will consider all the beams that are available to the user, check that any constraints are met in terms of latency or jitter between the VNFs, and they will then make an optimization based on the cost to make this as cost efficient as possible. So this sort of summarizes computation of the optimal placement of VNFs over the VMs by matching network service specific requirements to whatever infrastructure we have available and the runtime metrics while we consider the cost of compute and network. What we talked about now is sort of, this is what we have now. We have cost optimization. So we can say that put things where it's as cheap as possible, and we give no constraints. We can also present constraints in terms of latency and jitter between the components and say that optimize for the most cost-efficient distribution. For future, maybe we should optimize on something else. We could, for instance, consider to optimize on utilization. So try to fill up the edge data centers or try to move everything that is possible to move to a central data center. So that could be another type of criteria that we want to use. And I think also connecting to the previous presentation, capability matching. If we have workloads that, for instance, requires a specific capability in terms of hardware, maybe we need to run in an accelerator, it needs some sort of GPU support or something like that, then we could imagine that we do matching with capability constraints. Or maybe some aspects of EPA or these things that Mark talked about in the previous session. Some example use cases for this. Looking here on the top left-hand side, suppose this is sort of a 5G scenario in which we have this concept of UPFs in the new 5G core network, and the idea here is that you can do local breakout and doesn't have to transmit all the data up to a centralized core network. But if we have an application that want to use this, then it's reasonable that we actually have to put the actual application code in the same location as this user plane function which supports the local breakout. So that's more of a situation where we want to deploy as close as it must be. If we look at another down here on the right and lower side, we have a 4G core network. Then we can instead maybe in some cases ask the question, well, how far away can we put this then? Because normally things maybe might be cheaper if we can centralize it, a global data center, by economy of scale makes things run more efficiently and then maybe cheaper. So that's also a view you can have in this. And then we have this with the IoT example. Maybe we want to place application components close to the source of data to reduce transport cost or load on the transport network. So these could be some sort of different kind of use cases where this can be useful. As I mentioned, this is an optional module, so you need to install it with --PLA when you do installation of OSM. it's a new thing in release 8, so we have only basic functionality. It's actually not released for release 9 yet. It will come in the next point release. You will need two different configuration files, and these are the files that actually then makes the model that we talked about. What does it cost to execute or run a VNF in a specific VM? How are the VM interconnected? What's the topology of the VMs? What are the characteristics? How much does a link cost to use, and so forth? And in the current release, these are hard-coded. But in the future, you can, of course, think that we should retrieve this link characteristics data from the infrastructure by some monitoring mechanisms. It's also important to think or realize that these costs models doesn't really have to reflect the actual cost in dollars or euros or whatever. It can be an assigned cost that, because we want to give bias to a specific VM or specific links or things like that. So it can be used in that way also. Sometimes, of course, we have some sort of absolute constraints for which VM or VNF must be hosted on. So, for instance, we have an example here of a network service with three VNFs. And in this case, this VNF must go to VM number 3 because it has to be associated with a specific, to a VM with a specific VNF, for instance, a packet gateway, or a VM with connectivity to a PNF or a customer location, and so forth. This just follows the standard way that you do these pinnings in OSM when you do the NS create command. So this feature is optional, and it's invoked by the user when you do instantiate of a network service. So even if it's installed, you don't have to use it. If it is installed, you can invoke it by adding these instantiation parameters. So in the NSCreate, you add a dash dash config, and then we say that the placement engine should be PLA. And if we just do it that way, then it will be a simple cost optimization. Oftentimes, all the VNFs will end up in the most cheap VM then. And then we can extend this by pin a specific VNF to a specific VM. So in this case, the VNF identified as number 1 goes to OpenStack 3, which is the VM account in this example. You should also note that by design in release 9, these are still the old identifiers. So this will look like the identifiers from the old information model, and not from the Sol 006 information model. And that's not the specific thing for PLA. That goes for OSM in general. So I suppose there is a migration path on when this will be exchanged, but for release 9, it will look like this. Okay, moving on. You can also then add constraints on the virtual links. So here we say that the link, which is identified as VLD1, has some constraints for latency and jitter. And this other VLD has some constraints for jitter only. And then you can, of course, combine this. So you say that, well, this VNF has to go to this account or to this VM. The other VNFs in the service can go anywhere, just as long as they satisfy the constraints that are expressed here. And in this case, then, that this link should have a latency better than 15 milliseconds. A new thing in the adaptation to SOL006 from the information model in release 9 is that the NSD itself may define the constraints. So you have a new quality of service entry where you can express things like latency and packet delay variation, jitter in this case then. So if this is optional, of course, in the network service descriptor, if it's included, then it will be considered by PLA when PLA is invoked by using this dash dash config. It's also possible to override. So you could point to this link, to this virtual link descriptor, to this ID, and say that instead of what we have in the NSD, I want to have it like this, which means that you can both have more relaxed requirements, or you can decide to have more more tougher requirements than the NSD express. So a bit of example then quickly, just to see how this would look like in our service. So we have the firewall, Wiki, performance monitor, and LDAP, and so forth. And let's assume that we actually have two VIMs, which we don't have in the Hackfest, but we can imagine that we have this is sort of the default VIM that you use. And then we could think that, oh, we have a low cost VIM. So we see that it costs $5 to run the virtual desktop in this VIM. It only costs 2 in this low cost VIM, and then we have these characteristics for the interconnect between the VIMs. So if we only invoke PLA without any constraints or anything, then the system will select to deploy the virtual desktop in VIM number 2 because it gives the lowest total cost, compute, and transport. If we, on the other hand, say that, I want to have this optimal placed, but there's a constraints on the latency. Maybe because the user used some sort of application, so which is sensitive to lag, so we need to have good latency. Then we will conclude that, okay, this has to go to VIM number 1, even though it's more expensive, because we need to satisfy the latency constraints. And then if we do the same thing but relax the latency constraints a bit, well, then it again will realize that, okay, this can go to VIM number 2 because it gives the lowest total cost, and we still satisfy the latency constraints. So